Hello and welcome to My Secret Math Tutor Advanced. For this video, we're going to take on the proof of the triangle inequality, which of course you can do many ways, but we're going to tackle this one using cases. Now, of course, the triangle inequality, that's the one where you're taking the absolute value of the sum of a couple of numbers, and that this is less than or equal to the absolute value of each individual number added together. All right, so essentially what it's telling us is that we could split up the sum, but we may get something bigger, and we'll take the absolute value of each of these individually. Now, since we're doing this by cases, it's very important that we know what cases to break this into. And a really great way to get some intuition on what cases will be good or what cases we should consider is to actually just look at a bunch of different examples using some actual numbers. So here I have the triangle inequality, and I'm essentially looking at the left-hand side and the right-hand side using various different numbers I kind of picked out of thin air. So in other words, if I had 2 plus 3 in absolute value, well, what would this equal? Well, 2 plus 3 is 5, so I'd be looking at the absolute value of 5, and that just gives us 5. Whereas on the right-hand side, if we took the absolute value of each of these individually, what would that give us? Well, absolute value of 2, since it's positive, is just 2. Absolute value of 3 is just 3, so we're seeing here we have 5 again. All right, not too bad. Let's do another example. Here I have negative 3 and negative 4. Let's add those together. That'd give us a negative 7. This is an absolute value, so that'd give us a positive 7. Looking at the other hand, negative 3 in absolute value would be a positive 3, negative 4. Absolute value would give me a positive 4. So that just gives me a positive 7. All right, so what this is showing us is that it's perfectly possible that the left-hand side and the right-hand side of the triangle inequality could actually be equal, which is, of course, why this inequality is a little weaker. It has that or equals to sitting right there. So we should expect to consider that in our cases. All right, let's see what else we got here. Negative 4 plus 2, that's a negative 2. Absolute value would turn it to positive. Taking care of these individually, that'd be the absolute value of negative 4 is positive 4. Absolute value of 2 is 2. This would be 6. So here would definitely be a case where the right-hand side of that inequality is something bigger. All right, and one more, let's see. 3 plus a negative 7, that's a negative 4. Absolute value is positive. And let's see, 3 plus a 7, this would become 11. So here's yet another case where it looks like the right-hand side will definitely be bigger than the left-hand side. Now, what all of these examples really show us when we're using actual numbers in here is that the sign is going to be very important to keep track of. Here I had two numbers that were the same sign. These were both negative. Here I have different signs. One's negative, one's positive. So when we start breaking it down into cases, we really want cases that encompass all of those different signs. Which is positive? Which is negative? Which number is bigger? Which number is smaller? So let's move on to that. Since we're doing this on a case-by-case basis, we really have to be encompassing of everything that could happen with our value for x and y. Now, we don't necessarily want to spend a whole lot of time with a bunch of different cases of like this one's positive, this one's negative, this one's bigger, this one's smaller. And we will kind of get around that without loss of generality. But you know, there are some cases we definitely have to nail down. For example, it's perfectly possible that one of these values could be zero. Either x is zero or y is zero. And without loss of generality, we could just assume that one of them is zero and see how that plays out. A couple of other cases is that they both have the same sign, but maybe that sign is positive or maybe that sign is negative. And then the last case is really a couple of cases. We have to consider the case where x and y have different signs, so one is positive, one is negative. But then in that scenario, we have to also consider, well, which one is bigger? Is it the negative one that is bigger or is it the positive one that is bigger? And we're going to have to see how that plays out. All right, so this will encompass all the different things that could happen. And now we just have to go through them bit by bit and see how this plays out. So we'll start with the easiest case here at the top and work our way down. The first case doesn't look that interesting, but of course we're trying to make sure that we cover all of our bases. So this is one where we say, assume that one of these values is zero. And rather than doing two cases where x is zero and then y is zero, since they're both going to be about the same anyway, we will say without loss of generality, x is equal to zero. And of course, this special notation here is really just saying that if you really did do two cases here, they'd be exactly the same except with different notation. So we can get away with just assuming that x is equal to zero and call it good. All right, so let's do that. I'm going to start off with the left-hand side of that triangle inequality. So this would be x plus y. all an absolute value. And under our assumption, we're assuming that x is equal to 0. So we can go ahead and use that assumption to say that the absolute value of 0 plus y all an absolute value. All right, great place to start. Since we have a 0 in there, we can just ignore it. So now I'm just looking at the absolute value of y. And now I can start to unpackage this and say, well, if I add 0 on the outside of this absolute value, that certainly works. That's OK. And a 0 is the same as the absolute value of 0. So we can throw that in there. And like we said before, hey, x is equal to 0. So this literally turns into the right-hand side of that triangle inequality. So what have we shown here? We've shown that in this particular case, that the triangle inequality actually holds true. We've actually shown something a little bit stronger, that if one of these is 0, they're actually equal. But of course, we just want to do this showing that one is less than or equal to the other one. All right, so on to the second case. In the second case, it's going to be really important that we know exactly what the definition of the absolute value is. For example, if I'm taking the absolute value of a positive number, then the absolute value signs aren't really needed at all. We can just drop them entirely. However, if I'm taking the absolute value of a negative number, then it's the same as putting a negative sign in front of the number. This seems counterintuitive, but once you actually see it with a number, it makes complete sense. For example, here I have the absolute value of 3. 3 is a positive number, so those absolute values really aren't needed. But if I was taking the absolute value of, say, negative 4, then one way that I could achieve making it positive is by putting a negative sign right out in front of it. So here I have a negative of the negative 4, and that would make it positive, or a positive 4. So we're really just seeing that same process play out in symbols, in this notation. All right, so keep that in mind, and let's go ahead and look at that second case. In this next case, we're going to assume that x and y are both positive numbers. Like before, let's go ahead and start off with the left-hand side of the triangle inequality, where we're adding them in absolute value. Now, since we're assuming that x and y are both positive numbers, it means that their sum will be positive, okay? Since their sum is a positive number, then I'm taking the absolute value of a positive number. It means I really don't need those. So your justification here might be because x and y sum is positive. That's really why we're allowed to just drop them entirely. All right, moving on. Since individually they are positive numbers, we can use the definition of the absolute value again to throw absolute values around them individually. Now, this justification seems the same, but it's actually slightly different. It's because as individuals, they are positive. And that would take care of that case immediately. And again, you can see in this case, it's actually true that the inequality is equal. But in general, we're just after the inequality. OK, not too bad of a case. Let's move on to the third one. See how this one plays out. Very similar. This time, we're dealing with x and y. But we know that they are both negative numbers. All right, so what's going to happen now? Well, since x and y are negative numbers, it means that when we add them together, they will produce another negative number. It means that their sum is negative. And so if we think back to our definition, what do we do when we're taking the absolute value of a negative number? Well, we can make it positive by putting a negative number out front. So here you might say your justification is because their sum is negative. That'll work. All right, now let's move through this. We can distribute that negative sign to each of our terms, x and y. And now, individually, since x and y are negative numbers, we can package these up using our definition for absolute value once again. And again, this looks like the same justification, but it really is different. Here, I'm saying individually, they are negative. Nice. Which means we only have one more case to go. Before we jump into that case, we have to be very careful on how we're going to treat numbers that are different signs. So let's get a quick review on that. When you add numbers and they have different signs, you actually go through a process in your head that you may not be, you know, familiar with doing in symbols. First, you actually look at the absolute value of each number. Then you subtract the smaller absolute number from the larger absolute value number. And the sign of the result is really just going to be the same as the one with the largest in absolute value. As a good example to this, let's actually do it with some numbers and see how this works. So in other words, let's say I was adding a negative 7 and a plus 4. You know, mentally we could look at this and say, oh yeah, that's definitely negative 3. But remember, we're going to have to do this with symbols, so we want to be able to package this up using just x and y. All right, so watch how this happens. First, you might look at these in their absolute value. So here I have the absolute value 7. Here I have the absolute value 4. So that'd be a positive 7 and a positive 4. So really what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at the difference of these, okay? I'm going to say, all right, let's take the absolute value of the larger one, subtract the absolute value of the smaller one. And what sign should this result have? How big should I make it? Well, it should be the sign of whichever one of these is larger in absolute value, which is, of course, from the 7. So since the 7 was negative, the result of this needs to be a negative number. So this looks like a lot of work, but trust me, it's going to help us when we start doing this with symbols. Let's continue on from here. So let's see. A negative 7 in absolute value would turn it to a positive 7 minus a positive 4. So then I have 7 minus 4. That equal a 3. And this negative sign is just being carried along the ride, and we get the same value that we would expect. We get that negative 3. So watch for this process to play out when we're using x and y's. It is the same process, right? Let's give that a try with our next case. Case number 4. So we know that the numbers themselves are different signs. X is negative, y is positive, or it could be the other way around. But rather than breaking this into too many cases, again, we'll use this without loss of generality. We will say that x is the negative number, y is the positive number, and then recognize that if we had a couple of more cases, it'd really just be the values of these switched, but it'd look exactly the same. There will be a couple of cases where we do have to break it down, though, and that's dealing with which one is larger in absolute value. Is y the larger one? Is x the larger one? We'll have two cases for this, what I'll call 4a and 4b. So in this case, x is our negative number, y is our positive number, and y is the larger one in absolute value. Okay, so keep that in mind. Let's get into this. So if I was to look at their sum, just adding them straight across, well, then I'd have to say what their difference is in absolute value. Y is our larger one, so I'd take the absolute value of y minus the absolute value of x. Now remember, this is how we would take care of combining these numbers, and it'd have to have the same sign as the one that is in larger of absolute value. So what sign should we give this result? Well, y is the larger one in absolute value, and it's positive. So the sign of this result should be some sort of positive number. All right, that makes sense. So now let's look at this in absolute value. This looks more like what we're doing for the triangle inequality. So I just took the absolute value of both sides. But remember, over here, we already said that this result on the inside is going to be a positive number. And what do we do when positive numbers are in the absolute value? Well, we don't do anything. We can just drop it entirely. All right, so we're actually getting something very, very close to the triangle inequality. We see x plus y in absolute value on the left, and we see x and y on the right, but there's no plus sign in between. They have a negative sign. Well, that's okay. We can actually make it bigger. We can make it bigger by adding another absolute value of x. So let's see, something bigger, yes, this would be just a single old absolute value of y. But why stop there? Why add just a single absolute value of x? Maybe add another one, make it bigger again. So now I'll have absolute value of y plus absolute value of x. So really we can build that triangle inequality just by adding a couple of absolute values of x to the other side, and we're good to go. This shows that we're getting the strictly larger, but that's okay. Reverse the order, and we will see there's our triangle inequality. All right, that takes care of one case. Let's take care of the other one. This one's going to be very similar, again, without loss of generality. We will say that x is going to be the negative number, y is the positive number, but in this case, x is going to be the one that is larger in absolute value. All right, so like before, let's see what happens when we start adding things. So x plus y. Like before, we'd subtract the one that is larger in absolute value. So let's see, since y is smaller, it's being subtracted from the larger one. That looks good. And let's see, what else do we know? Well, this result has to have the same sign as the one that is the larger in absolute value. So this result is going to be a negative number. Makes sense. All right. So now we have to think carefully, what's going to happen when we throw it in absolute value? What's going to happen in that case? All right. So let's go ahead and take the absolute value of both sides. That looks good. As we said before, we know that this inside piece is going to be a negative number. So how do we treat it with these absolute values? We will throw a negative sign. That will essentially make it positive. All right, that fits our definition good, and we can move on. Distributing that negative sign, we will have a negative absolute value of x. Negative times a negative will give us a positive. And now we're in the exact same spot that we were before. All we need to do is add a couple of absolute values of x here. So let's say we'll add two absolute values of x, making that right-hand side strictly larger. And now we see that triangle inequality again. So since that's the last case, and in every single case the triangle inequality held, then we know that it really is proved, that the triangle inequality really is a valid inequality. Right? Hopefully that helps you look at the different cases for the triangle inequality and shows that knowing the definitions of even the most basic things is really important when making a proof. If you'd like to see some more videos, definitely visit MySecretMathTutor.com.